Hey guys, John from FlyMikeAlpha.com, and today we're going to be going over everything underneath the cowling of our Piper Cherokee. All the parts, what they do, where the wires and lines run to. Hopefully that'll give you a better understanding of what's actually going on under the hood of your airplane. So we can see we got our cowling opened up here. We have our engine cylinders. The valve covers are these pieces right here. Those are our valve covers. And going into our cylinders, we notice these lines running. Well, we have spark plug wires. That's these wires running here that go down to our spark plugs, which go into our engine cylinder. We have one for our front cylinder as well. This little copper line running here that's going right into the intake side. See, this is our intake pipe. We have an exhaust pipe over there. We have another exhaust pipe for our other cylinder and another intake pipe. So that little copper line running here, that is a primer line. So when you pump the primer on the engine, that actually squirts fuel through this little copper line right into the intake tube so that when the engine first turns, it pulls fuel right directly into the cylinder to help it start up before it starts mixing the air and fuel together in the carburetor, which is at the very bottom of these intake tubes. And the air-fuel mixture flows through the intake tubes, gets burnt up in the cylinder, and then the exhaust, of course, goes out the exhaust side. You can see these spark plugs have a little bit of carbon or a little chalky buildup on it, and that's just from a little exhaust leak that's been repaired here. Some of these exhaust gaskets were leaking a little. So we have our exhaust pipe that runs out here to this shroud, and this shroud is for our carburetor heat. So there's actually a hole underneath it, so we'll take a look underneath the shroud and notice there's that hole, and we can see air flows through that hole around the hot exhaust pipe, and then it's going to flow through that shroud into this scat tubing here. And the scat tubing definitely needs to be replaced because it has none of the springs left in it, none of the rusty springs in it. It needs to be rigid, so that needs to be addressed by the mechanic for sure. And as we come back here, we can take a look and see that 2 or 3 inch scat tube line flows right to our air box in the carburetor where it says Schiebler on it. That is the carburetor. So that's our fuel bowl. Then we see these little cables here, and this is actually our mixture and throttle cable. So if we were to move the mixture and throttle in the cockpit, those cables move back and forth to adjust the mixture and also the throttle plate on the carburetor. Now that's our carb heat scat tubing, our normal airflow comes from up front here. We'll see if we can get a good shot of that. And so from the front of the cowling, we have that other 3-inch scat tube that is where our normal supplied air comes from to the carburetor. And where they join together, that is the air box. And there's just a little butterfly valve that selects whether you're using carb heat or hot intake air that's unfiltered or air that's flowing through the air filter. And if we come back here, walk around to the front of the airplane, we can see that this is our air filter, and that's where the air is flowing through as it goes to the air box for our carburetor. Next part we're going to look here is back at our cowling. We have this orange flapper stuff, and that is baffling. The job of the baffling is actually to keep airflow as it's coming through the front of the cowling there, airflow through our big cooling intakes here, flowing over the cylinders and actually forcing the air to flow down in between the cylinders through these cooling fins and forcing the airflow to flow all around the cylinders, taking as much heat away as possible. So the baffling is very important to ensure you have a cool running engine. The next thing you can see is, although the air might get a little warm as it flows over the cylinders, it actually flows right into this little hole there. And as it goes through that hole, it comes back to this 3-inch scat tubing, which then feeds into our shroud over our muffler, so another heating shroud, to heat air for our defrost, which is the skinny little 1-inch tube there on the other side. So right where I'm shining my light, that is the defrost hot air going into the cabin. And then on the bottom side here, we can see a little 2-inch line that's not connected, that should be. And right there is where our 2-inch scat tube should be coming out to heat the cabin and then go down to our cabin air box down there. And that's where we actually are able to select cabin heat on or off. And if we turn it off, we simply just close the door and the hot air blows out the bottom of that airbox. So if we take a look at the bottom of the airbox there, that's our little flapper valve there where the hot air, where the scat tube should be hooked up to on this side, coming in that way. And if the cabin heat is off, it just blows out the bottom here. If the cabin heat's on, the little door closes this bottom and forces the hot air into the cabin. Next thing we can see from this side here that I'll shine my light at, that little bicycle valve tube looking thing, that is a Schrader valve, and that is the top of the nose strut where you fill the nose strut with 5606 hydraulic fluid and nitrogen to give it its shock absorbing ability. And that little piston thing behind it right there, that little piston thing, is the shimmy dampener to reduce the shimmy in the nose gear. Come around the front of the airplane. Through the front side here, we can see our ring gear, basically our flywheel or flex plate, as some people might call it if they're familiar with automotive parts. That is where our starter is going to engage to turn the propeller. Here is our alternator belt, and that's connected basically to the crankshaft, to the flywheel of the motor. So as the engine spins, it spins that belt, which drives the pulley on the alternator, which charges our battery. And we can actually come back around inside here, look up inside the engine there, and there's our alternator. There's our big battery wires going to it. And that's a relatively new shiny alternator. We'll come back out here. And coming around the other side, we'll be able to get a better view of our starter. So now we can see where the starter pinion gear, when we press the start button, will come out, and that will engage with the ring gear and turn the crankshaft, turn the propeller, turn the engine, get it fired up. And then once it's running, the pinion pops back in place. So it pops out to start and then goes back in once the engine's running. On the front side here, we have our oil cooler. So that's responsible for taking in some cool air from out in front of the engine and keeping the oil cool. So the engine is not just air cooled, it's also oil cooled. It relies on cool oil to take the heat away from the metal parts inside the engine. If we come back around the back side here, we look at our oil cooler, we'll notice two orange hoses coming off of it. And those orange hoses are oil cooler lines. So we can kind of come back here and take a look where they flow to. And those two oil cooler lines come up and into the motor right there. So we have one going in there and then one going in just below the oil filter. And that white thing with the safety wire on it right here, that is our oil filter. Much like an oil filter on a car, except on these ones, we actually write the tail number of the airplane, the tack time it was done. So if you ever want to know when the last oil change was done on the airplane, you should be able to look right on the oil filter and it'll be written Sharpie on there. And so that's where our two oil cooler lines go to. So oil gets pumped out to the oil cooler, gets cooled, and then pumped back into the engine to keep the engine cool. On the back here, we see this big black box. There's another one on the other side. If we trace where these wires are coming from out of that black box, well, those are spark plug wires. So this is our left-hand magneto. We can see the LH there. The other black box on the other side, on the opposite side of that oil filter there, that would be our right-hand magneto. And we follow those spark plug wires, and we see that they come to our spark plugs on our motor. And we could also follow the wires out of it that go up to the top here, and they go to the top spark plugs. Each cylinder, of course, has two spark plugs, one on the top, one on the bottom. Bottom ones typically will foul with lead first. And on any given cylinder, the top plug is going to be controlled by a different magneto than the bottom plug. So you'll never have the left-hand magneto controlling both the top and bottom plug for this cylinder. One looks like the bottom plug here is controlled by the left-hand magneto, and the top one is fired by the right-hand magneto. And that's just for redundancy, so that if you lose one magneto, all four cylinders will still get spark, and you'll notice a small reduction in power, but hopefully nothing too huge or dangerous. Other things to note on this side of the motor, we can look here, we have our air coming in, we have our baffling, and we see that we have another little 2-inch tube there, 2-inch hole going to a 2-inch scat tube, and that scat tubing comes down to this little box in here, this little shroud, and that shroud is around our engine-driven fuel pump. How we know it's our engine-driven fuel pump? So we can follow the orange lines here, and we can find out that these are fuel lines. If we follow where they go to, we see it goes right to the carburetor down there. We'll shine a light to make it a little easier to see. So those fuel lines go right to our carburetor. We can see that we have inline and also a return line. And the return line comes back to feed our primer. You can see the return line is teed in with a little fitting right there. If I can tilt this right, let's see if we can show you guys. This fitting right here by my finger, where it turns into a copper line, that goes back into the cockpit, these copper lines here, and those are primer lines going to the primer for the intake for the primer, and then the skinny ones are the output for the high pressure fuel coming from the primer being pumped back to the engine cylinders when you're trying to start up. Now, we notice another 2-inch scat tubing down here at the bottom going to this box shaped thing. Well, that box or shroud is actually what houses our electric fuel pump. So we have some electric wires here as well as fuel lines going in to that box. And obviously the fuel lines come in for our electric fuel pump, come out right there. That's a fuel line, this little skinny 1-inch one. The 2-inch scat tube, the job of that is to blow cool air into there to keep the electric fuel pump cool when you're operating on the ground or even in the air to keep it from overheating. So we come down to the bottom of the cowling here and we notice this big air scoop. Well, that air scoop is what feeds that 2-inch scat tube right there through the bottom of the cowling, and it flows into the air box for the electric fuel pump. Other things to note here, we've got our starter solenoid. We know it's a starter solenoid because, well, it looks like a relay of some sort. There's some skinny wires going to it. Those would be the wires going to your starter switch. There's some big, heavy wires going to it, really big, strong ones that carry a lot of current. Well, that also feeds to the starter. So basically, you're able to control a big flow, a big load, electrical load, with a tiny little switch in the cockpit. So it's basically just a relay. And if you want to know more about relays, you can YouTube that, and we'll have another video to explain relays. Over here, we have our brake fluid reservoir, and I know it looks kind of like just a tin can, but that's literally brake fluid reservoir. There's a steel line that goes through the firewall and goes down to your master cylinders on your brake pedals. Other things to note on this side of the airplane, I think that almost covers it. We do have this one funny little pipe here coming out of the engine, and that is a crankcase breather. If we follow that metal tube down, we see that it just dead ends on the bottom of the airplane. We can kind of come around here and take a look and see if we can see it better. And so that is just the crankcase breather for all the blow by past the piston ring, so all that gas doesn't build up in the crankcase, it can be expelled overboard. Along with your electric fuel pump in this little compartment is your gas glider, and that's that little T-fitting down there. There is a little steel bowl, so to speak, that we can kind of see by looking up in there. That little steel bowl is supposed to catch all the water, and then we have that little drain on that steel bowl that when we push up, we drain some fuel and hopefully drain whatever's water and is in the system out before we go fly. And let's see, from this side of the cowling, we can see this one wire here. That little wire is actually connected directly to the crankshaft and it measures engine RPM. So it's a little wire inside of that casing and it spins around and that goes to our tachometer. So there's just a little metal wire spinning around in there and that is actually what feeds our tachometer. So as soon as that propeller turns, it'll start registering on the tachometer. And then this little thing with the red bands around it looks like a pump of some sort. If we follow those rubber tubes coming off of it, here's one rubber tube coming off back into the cockpit, that is our vacuum pump. So we have basically the air that's pulling being expelled overboard and then the low pressure suction being pulled through this tube right here. So that little guy back in there, that is our vacuum pump. These little thin wires here, right there, those little thin wires, those are going to your ignition switch, and we can follow them from the firewall forward here to the magneto, and we can see that they're on the magneto, though. Those are P leads. So the job of the P-lead is actually to ground out the magneto and stop supplying spark to the spark plug when you turn the ignition switch to off. So if that tiny, skinny, thin little wire breaks or becomes disconnected, when you turn the key off, the engine, if it's already running, will continue to run, or if it's off, could accidentally start if you turn the propeller by hand. So those skinny little wires, that is what you check when you momentarily turn the magneto switch to off when you right before you shut down the engine to make sure you don't have any broken P-leads. Coming back out here, we'll walk back around. One last thing I want to show you guys, I don't think I went over the first time. We have this little line coming out here, and that comes to the most important part of the airplane, and that is a pressure switch. It trips at 4 psi as soon as there's 4 psi of oil pressure. This is an oil line. As soon as there's 4 psi in this oil line, we can see these two wires coming into it and going back into the cockpit. That is just an open-closed switch that runs the Hobbs meter. So if you want to save some money on your flight training, come out here before your flight, undo that screw, and the Hobbs meter will not work. And that is the best advice that I could possibly give you during your flight training career. Other things here that comes out of this T-fitting, this is basically all these wires for your oil pressure. That's going to your oil pressure gauge, and some of these other wires are going to your temperature sensor inside the engine there. So this is your oil pressure switch, which actually measures a numeric value of oil pressure and displays it digitally in the cockpit. And that just about covers it. Can't think of too many other things. These are just great little things to check on your pre-flight, make sure they haven't moved at all. That is, connects the intake tube to the intake that flows through the oil sump. This is where all the oil is kept, and this little blue thing down here is the oil drain. So when they do an oil change, they just open up this little blue valve there, all the oil drains out. And because the oil is hot, it actually kind of keeps the air, or keeps the carburetor a little warmer than usual, so that helps prevent carb ice on Cherokees. And also, because the cool fuel air mixture flowing through the carburetor into the intake pipes is flowing through the hot oil sump, the air going into the engine actually acts to help cool the oil. So that's actually part of the way that Piper designed this in Lycoming, to help keep your oil cool and ultimately help keep your engine cool, so that the intake air flows from the carburetor through the hot oil, then to the intake pipe, then into the cylinder. So the cool air coming in through the front of the engine, mixing with the cool fuel, helps keep the engine cool overall before it burns it, makes it very hot. I think that's just about it. If you guys have any other questions about stuff you saw here, anything I should have pointed out and didn't, don't hesitate to leave it in the comments below. I'd be happy to answer any questions. Thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel to keep up with all our latest videos. Please give us a thumbs up on our video and any of the other ones you watch. And be sure to share us with your friends, family on Facebook, Twitter, all that. Let them know that we are out here making all these flight instruction videos for you. Greatly appreciate you guys watching. Hope you fly safe. Make sure you fly every day. And if you don't, then fly at MikeAlpha.com. We'll see y'all next time.